Let me welcome all of you today to the Peterson Institute for International Economics. I'm Fred Bergsten. I was the founding director of the Institute, now a senior fellow and director emeritus here, and delighted to welcome you for this particularly important and timely event. We all know that trade has now become a central issue in the domestic political debate. We know that the impact of trade on jobs and wages is central to that debate. And we now have with us today the leading experts on that topic of the impact of trade on U.S. jobs and wages, David Autor and Gordon Hansen, who along with their other colleague, David Dorn, have done a series of papers that I think is fair to say are the definitive work on the topic, widely regarded and widely used and cited throughout the national debate. In fact, so much so that a couple of people coming up and meeting them before the event said, ah, you guys are now rock stars. We're delighted that we knew you back when, which I think is probably accurate. Also, I must say, very much to their credit, they have, on the one hand, quite objectively analyzed some very severe adverse impacts of past China shock trade flows on the U.S. economy and U.S. labor. And at the same time, they have said, but we don't dump on free trade and open trade and globalization. We think it makes sense, but you have to deal with these downsides and costs of the situation. And they've been very clear, for example, they support the TPP. They're not saying turn your back on trade, but they are flagging in a dramatic way, I think, as well as a highly persuasive and analytically based way, the problems that do emerge and have not been dealt with adequately. So that's the topic for today. David Autor is one of the most distinguished trade economists in the country. He's been a professor of economics, full professor of economics at MIT since 2008, associate head of the economic department there. He had taught previously at Harvard and the University of Chicago. He's won many awards for his work on labor economics, the Sherwin Rosen Prize in 2008 for outstanding contributions in the field of labor economics, and many other awards of that type. His co-presenter today and co-author in that whole range of studies they've done is Gordon Hansen, who's professor of economics at the University of California, San Diego. As some of you know, we here at the Institute refer to that as the Peterson Institute West because we've had so much collaboration with Gordon, Miles Kaler, who's here, and many other colleagues at UCSD. Gordon holds the Pacific Economic Cooperation Chair in International Economic Relations at UCSD. He's director of the Center on Global Transformation. Both David and Gordon are research associates at the National Bureau of Economic Research. David is editor of the Journal of Economic Perspectives, and Gordon is a co-editor thereof. So they're going to make the initial presentations, and then we will have initial commentary by Jared Bernstein. Jared, as many of you here in Washington know, is a senior fellow at the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, prior to which, for the first 2 or 3 years of the Obama administration, he was a central member of its economic team as a chief economist and economic advisor to Vice President Biden. Prior to that, Jared had been active at the Economic Policy Institute, has written widely in both academic and popular venues on issues of labor economics, labor reform, and the like. So I think we have an absolutely central topic for today's discussion. We have, I think, the best possible authors and speakers to present new and critically important findings on those topics. And without further ado, I'll turn to David. Gordon's going to go first, okay, Gordon to lead off. He'll then hand off to David. Jared will make comments, and then we'll all go up front thereafter for discussion with the audience. Gordon, take it away.
Thanks very much, Fred. We really appreciate the opportunity to present our work here today. It's been an exciting project that David Autor, David Dorn, and I have been embarked on the last number of years. And one of the things we want to try and communicate today in understanding the impact of trade on labor markets is, in a sense, how can we hold at the same time the belief that trade has had adverse consequences for important segments of the U.S. labor force and still think that trade is good in the aggregate. That sort of subtlety is something that's very much gotten lost in the current political debate. So we don't need to motivate the notion that trade and politics are intimately entwined today. Trade has become a punching bag both on the Republican side in Donald Trump's presidential campaign and in Bernie Sanders' campaign. It's useful in thinking about why trade has become such a lightning rod to go backwards in time and think about how we got here. So go back to the early 1990s when we were negotiating the North American Free Trade Agreement and the promise of globalization that was presented, not just in the United States, but around the world. And the idea was that globalization was going to make the U.S. economy better off. That's a notion that's well founded in economic theory. There's a substantial amount of economic research that backs up that idea. What we didn't pay as much attention to at that time was the possibility that trade could have adverse impacts on certain parts of the labor force, on certain regions of the United States that happen to be more specialized in industries that are import competing. So that inattention to the vulnerability of certain key parts of the U.S. economy to trade left us vulnerable to possible disrupting effects of other aspects of globalization. Well, what was the big disrupting feature of globalization in the last two decades? It wasn't NAFTA. NAFTA's impacts in the U.S. economy were trifling relative to what the impact of China's growth has been. So we now are very familiar with the idea that China has had enormous consequences for the global economy as China has lifted several hundred million people out of poverty in its own economy. It's transformed the way in which global markets operate. That's ex post wisdom. If we go back to 1989, 1990, think about what the world looked like going forward, China's future potential was very much in doubt. In 1989, the Wall Street Journal, in prognosticating about what would happen in the 1990s, said, let's think about the three economies that are most likely to excel in the coming decade, and they were Bangladesh, Thailand, and Zimbabwe. They identified China as likely to be a laggard in the coming decade because it wouldn't be able to shake off the stultifying effects of communist bureaucracy. Lo and behold, the world turned out to be much different than we thought. And I don't want to beat up on journalists here. Economists were just as far behind in terms of understanding what China's future impacts would behold. What we want to emphasize here is that this was really a once-in-an-epoch change. China had, because of the consequences of Mao's policies, kept itself tremendously backwards relative to the rest of the world. While we'd had four decades of technological advance, China had pretty much stayed in 1949. So that meant that there was tremendous latent productivity growth that was waiting to happen. Deng Xiaoping's process of reform and opening unleashed that growth. And so that was a big part of China's emergence. If you go back to 1991, imports from China accounted for only about 1% of total U.S. expenditure on manufactured goods in the United States. That 1% is now around 10% today. There are many causal factors behind that change, and our work has not been focused on understanding those causal factors behind China's growth, but rather understanding their consequences on the U.S. Economy. I know many folks at the Peterson Institute have emphasized the role that currency manipulation played in China's growth. Others have emphasized the role of reform in state-owned enterprises. China's accession to the WTO unleashed a complicated set of reforms in the economy that helped growth accelerate. All of those are valid considerations for why China's economy grew so fast. So what did it then mean for the United States? Well, if we were to kind of take trade theory at the time and say what would China have done, we would have thought in terms of broad classes of workers. It's going to hurt blue-collar workers relative to white-collar workers. It's going to help the more educated and hurt the less educated in both a relative and perhaps an absolute sense. And this is decades, if not centuries, of economic theory on this, well-founded in the traditions of Heckscher-Ohlin. And so that's what we had thought, that we should see these diffuse effects across big sectors of the U.S. labor market. Well, in truth, what happened was a lot more complicated. This conventional wisdom that when we have interaction with an economy like China,
it's going to spill out generally across lower wage workers turned out to be not quite right. China's impacts have been much more concentrated than that, and trying to understand those concentrated impacts has been what our work has focused on. So to give you a sense of these consequences, what we're going to do is very quickly run through what we've learned about the labor market consequences of trade, talk about how does that learning change the way in which we think about the economics of trade and adjustment to trade shocks, and then talk about policy. What has policy done to help or to impede adjustment at the worker level and at the regional level from happening, and what might effective policies be going forward in time? So one thing that hasn't been surprising about China's impacts is that the firms and the industries that have been most directly in the line of fire from China have been hurt. So if you look at industries where import penetration from China has grown at a more rapid clip, what we've seen is higher rates of exit of manufacturing plants, and we've seen larger declines in employment in plants that have stayed in operation. So that part's not surprising. You get more import competition, you're going to see disruptive effects. What has been surprising to us is the scale of those of that disruption at the industry level. So what our work suggests is that the direct impacts of increasing import competition from China can account for about 1 million lost manufacturing jobs in the United States, which is about 17% of the decline in manufacturing employment over the two decades that we look at. More surprising still has then been to think about not just what happens at the industry level, but what happens at the local labor market level. If you think about the U.S. economy, it's a collection of communities, a collection of cities that specialize in quite different things. We have parts of the Southeast. We have parts of the Southern Midwest that are heavily manufacturing-oriented. We have other parts of the country that do very little manufacturing. Then when we think about manufacturing regions themselves, there's also enormous heterogeneity in those localities. Some manufacturing areas specialize in heavy equipment. Some specialize in automobiles. Others specialize in more labor-intensive industries. So if you map this out and just say, if we go back to 1990 and ask, based on the patterns of specialization across communities in the United States at the beginning of that decade, who was then, what did exposure to the coming China trade shock look like? What we see is a checkerboard map. Darker colors here show U.S. commuting zones. These are our measures of local labor markets that were more exposed to import competition from China over the subsequent two decades. Lighter colors indicate areas that were less affected. What you see is a very striking absence of uniformity. And what you also see, looking through the current political lens, is a lot of those darker colored areas, the areas that were more exposed to trade, to increase in trade competition, look like Trump country. That is, in fact, what we find. I'm going to plug work we have in progress right now, looking at the consequences of trade exposure for political outcomes in the United States. You see increasing support for politicians at the extremes, primarily on the right, a bit on the left, in response to increasing exposure to trade. That highlights the long-run consequences of some of these shocks. So you then say, okay, fine, we've got areas in the Southeast, we've got areas in the Southern Midwest that are hit by increased import competition. What should we expect to see happen? Well, kind of what we thought was the standard rule of adjustment is employment declines, workers leave those regions and go to areas that have greater job growth. This is just part of dynamic adjustment that's part and parcel of what makes the U.S. labor market more flexible relative to Europe. What our work has found, and it's not just our work, it's a growing body of work in labor economics that looks at other types of shocks to these local communities, is that out-migration response has not been an active market margin of adjustment to increasing responses in import competition. So those industries that have gotten hit by greater trade competition with China, they've seen declines. The regions in which those industries are located then see declines in those industries that then spill out in non-traded activities locally. And instead of workers leaving declining regions, what we have seen is adjustment along other margins. We've seen absolute declines in employment as a share of the working age population, as workers have exited the labor force or transitioned on to long-run unemployment. We've also seen, as a consequence of that, greater uptake of government benefits, which David will talk more about in a couple of minutes. So in the paper, we kind of go through great pains to try and put precise metrics on what the nature of the of this adjustment looks like. And the metric we use, let's think about a commuting zone, let's think about a local labor market that's at the 25th percentile of trade exposure. That is, you know, one that's just, that hasn't been that affected by import competition from China. And let's contrast that with a local labor market that's at the 75th percentile. So high exposure versus low exposure. That difference in exposure amounts over the period we examined, the 90s and early 2000s, to an increase of about an extra $1,000 of imports from China per worker. What's the consequence of that greater exposure? So in manufacturing industries, it's a decline in employment as a share of the working age population of about 0.6 percentage points. That might not seem like a big number, but this is the share of employment in the working age population, which has changed over time by a magnitude of about 3.5 percentage points. So that decline is a big number. Now, if workers were smoothly adjusting between regions, what should have then happened? Well, they just moved into other industries, move into non-traded activities or leave the region entirely. We've seen neither of those things occur. As I just mentioned, what has happened is a movement out of the labor force and increases in unemployment that persist over periods of a decade or longer. Not surprisingly, that the adverse consequences, the exits from the labor force and the persistence in unemployment, is more concentrated among lower educated workers. So that's one big lesson that we've learned from our research, is that there is this differential exposure of local labor markets to trade. Those areas that have been hit have had persistent declines, decreases in manufacturing presence, decreases in employment as a share of the population overall without successful outmigration. One other important margin of adjustment that I'll talk about, and then turn it over to David to think about putting these results in perspective and talk about policy, is now, instead of thinking about industries or think about regions, let's think about individual workers. And let's go back to 1991, and let's imagine two workers that are similar in every observable respect. They have the same number of years of labor market experience. They have the same earnings history. They work for similar employers in terms of the size of that firm and the number of and the average wages that firm pays. The only manner in which these two workers differ is that one works in an industry that is going to get hit by the China shock, and one works in an industry that is not going to get hit by the China shock. So what we've learned from labor economics is that workers who are displaced from their jobs have long-term adverse consequences. There are scarring effects from job loss. So that's not new to our paper. This is work that's been was established by labor economics research in the early 1990s. What we find is very much the same story in the trade context. That more exposed worker, if you think about that worker's twin, sees a substantially lower earnings over that worker's over the subsequent two decades, what you can think as lower lifetime earnings as a consequence of that greater exposure. Now, to come back to the differential exposure according to worker characteristics, now let's consider two sets of twins. Okay, one set are low wage workers, and the other set are high wage workers. All of those adverse consequences happen among that lower wage pair. That is, for workers who are lower income, they are the ones for whom greater exposure to import competition from China meant lower earnings in the long run. If we think about that pair, that pair of two high-income workers, the consequences of greater trade exposure just don't show up. So in sum, what we've seen is less flexibility in response to these shocks as a consequence of trade, and so more concentrated losses from trade exposure. This is not that old Heckscher Ohlin story of blue-collar workers suffering. It's about particular labor markets, it's about particular industries, and indeed particular types of workers. And that may be in part why the policy response to those shocks hasn't been as effective as we might want it to be. So as in our research, we're tag teaming here. I will let David then talk about lessons and policy issues.
Great. Thank you very much. It's an honor and a pleasure. And I should clarify, I'm really a labor economist, not a trade economist. And so I've tried, you know, the collaboration that Gordon and David, Doran and I have done has tried to bring a kind of a labor economic sensibility to these trade questions in trying to use microdata and as much as possible a clear source of variation to identify these causal effects. So I want to now step back from some of the results that Gordon talked about and try to put them in context. And there are two questions I want to address. First, should we be surprised by the large effects we find on workers who are displaced by trade? Second, what's the problem? Is it trade adjustment or is it trade itself? Is it the process of getting from here to there or is it just the mere fact that we're trading? And I think this is an issue that has a lot of is subject of a lot of debate, and so I want to weigh in on that. And then finally, I want to talk about has U.S. policy response been effective and what how could it be potentially more effective? So let me start with this question of should we be surprised by large earnings losses? So this figure is from a paper on job loss. And this just looks at displaced workers. It's by Steve Davis and Till von Wachter. It's a Brookings paper of a couple years ago. And it looks at average earnings of displaced workers, a percentage of pre-displacement earnings over a trajectory of 20 years from displacement. So zero is the year of displacement. And you can see for a worker displaced in an expansion, they initially lose about 25% to 30% of annual earnings. And even 20 years out, they have lost, they're still 10% down. If you look at workers displaced in recessions, that initial loss is 40%, and 20 years out, they're 20% down. And so this finding that workers displaced from long-term employment suffer permanent scarring effects has been around. It first came out in work by Jacobs, Blum, Lund, and Sullivan looking at workers displaced in Pennsylvania during the big steel contraction in the 1980s, and it's been corroborated by dozens of subsequent studies. So we know that this is a robust fact. So we shouldn't entirely be surprised that workers displaced by trade also suffer large losses. That's always been true. A second thing is, filling in on this point, this figure shows you the relationship between the size of the earning loss over the first 3 years and the initial unemployment rate at the time that job loss occurs. And so as you move right, you're moving into deeper recessions. And as you move down, those are large losses. So someone displaced, let's say, in 1999, when the labor market was extremely tight, would tend to lose about 10% of earnings over the next 3 years because they'd quickly get reemployed. Someone displaced in 1983, when the labor market was extremely slack, would lose about 30 percentage points over the next 3 years. So it matters when the shock occurs. And the greatest acceleration of the China shock occurred after 2001, after China's accession to WTO, and that was a very slack labor market. After the 2000 recession, there was almost no job growth in the United States between 2000 and 2007. The unemployment rate was relatively low, but the labor force participation rate was falling quite steeply. And so there was kind of a hidden recession going on. And if you look at 2005, 2004, and 2003, you can see that for the level of measured unemployment, the job losses, the earnings losses were much larger than you would have predicted. And we think, you know, part of that is because the labor market was actually in worse shape than was perceived at that time. And only in retrospect, if there had never been a great recession, we would still say that the 2000s was a lost decade for the U.S. labor market. That's how serious that was. So just to put that in context, so it says job loss is costly. It's more costly when the outside options aren't very good. And so we had the China shock was accompanied by large quantities of job loss and people being dropped into effectively kind of labor market quicksand from which it was very difficult to emerge during the 2000s. You might say, well, why is that shock so persistent? Why does it have such long-term effects? Well, one thing we looked at in our data when looking at displaced manufacturing workers is how once they're displaced from manufacturing, How exposed are they to further shocks? Well, that depends where they go, right? If you're displaced by from textiles and you go into leather goods, well, you're going to be shocked again. If you're displaced by from textiles and you go into aircraft engines, you're not going to be be shocked again. So this figure, I'll explain this very briefly. The blue line, the blue series of dots, shows you the correlation between your exposure in 1991 and your subsequent exposure over subsequent years. So it's initially 1, it falls to about 0.5 over the course of 20 years. If you look at the red line, that shows you a counterfactual in which workers, once they're displaced, move out of manufacturing. And so once they're initially shocked, they're no longer exposed. And you can see that's a much steeper fall. So what that tells you is a lot of workers who are displaced from one trade-impacted sector move into another and are shocked again, and especially low-skill workers. They tend to stay within manufacturing, and so they keep getting hit again. And so part of the reason the losses are so persistent is because it's not a one-time event, even for the individuals who first experience it. Okay, so now let me come to it. So that's a kind of labor economics point, and really all this says is something we've known for a long time about the cost of job loss. We're seeing through a trade lens at a magnitude, a scale that we didn't previously see. So now there's another question. What is the problem? Is it the adjustment or is it just the mere fact of trade itself? And my frequent colleague and ever-present critic, Larry Michel, wrote on his blog recently. He said, tired of economists' misdirection on globalization. He's referred to our work. Said, trade theory tells us that globalization's impact is much greater on the wages of all non-college grads, not just a few dislocated manufacturing workers. The damage is widespread. Trade theory says the result is a permanent, not temporary, lowering of wages of all unskilled workers. So Gordon and I have been emphasizing the cost to displaced workers, and the view from some quarters is, no, that's a sideshow. It's the whole economy that's being affected, not just these workers. So it's important to ask, what is the bigger deal here? So in the short and medium run, we know that the costs of job loss are sharp and they're steep and they're scarring, and concentration matters. So imagine taking two different welfare experiments or social experiments. One, we pick one individual and we take $10,000 away from that person. Another one, we take 10,000 people and take $1 away from each of them. Which of those does more harm in aggregate? Clearly, the concentrated harm is much greater because no one's going to feel it if you take a dollar away from them, but when you take $10,000 away, they're going to lose their house, right? So it matters that the shocks are concentrated. So we know that's going on in the short and medium run. Well, what about the long run? Trade theory says, look, if you increase the supply of a previously scarce factor, its price is going to tend to fall. So in the long run, prices and wages are going to change. There's going to be lower prices of goods and services, but also lower wages for workers who are made less scarce by globalization. And the wage effects should not be limited to manufacturing. They should be limited to they should be expanded to the entire skill group. So how much do we see that? Well, it's a harder question to answer. There's an old line of work on this. There's a very well-known paper by Borjas, Freeman, and Katz published in 1997. And they try to do a kind of a calibration exercise. And this is basically you take all of the goods that are being imported, you turn them back into units of labor. Imagine they were made domestically by domestic workers. How much labor is embodied in those goods? How much are we increasing the effective supply of low-skill labor in the U.S. by importing these goods? Some trade economists don't like this calculation. I think they've gotten more comfortable with over time. It actually makes a lot of sense in an economy like the U.S. that responds to its own supplies to a great deal. So they make this calculation. It's only to 1995. I'm going to update it here for you. They say, look, trade, U.S. GDP trade rose from 2.3 to 3.9% of GDP, LDC, excuse me, less developed economy. That probably reduced high school dropouts versus high school graduate wages by 0.6 to 1.2 percentage points and raised college relative to high school wages by 0.7 to 1.4 percentage points. That's not zero, but that's very small on the scale of wage changes that occurred in that period. High school dropout wages fell on the order of 20%. College graduate wages rose on the order of 25% in that period. So that's real but small. But you might say, well, that's to 1995. We know the big shock was coming. And that's true. This shows you U.S. good imports from China as a share of U.S. GDP between 1991 and 2004. And it rose from 0.3% to 2.7% in that period. And you can see, by the way, a lot of that occurred immediately after 2001. So the rise between 1991 and 2001 was 0.7 percentage points. After 2001, that was another 1.7 percentage points in just 12 years. So enormously rapid. So we just do a little back-of-the-envelope calculation, taking that same Borjas, Freeman, and Katz exercise and just applying the new data from China to say how much did the China shock over this period affect wages in aggregate, assuming that market's clear, that it's not just concentrated on those individual workers, but spread through U.S. economy. Well, just to get to the bottom line, over 1991 to 2014, we would say it lowered high school dropout to high school versus high school graduate wages by about 1 percentage points to 1.8 percentage points, and it raised college grad relative to high school graduate wages by 1 to 2 percentage points. Again, not zero, but small. That's very small on the scale of the wage changes we've seen, the changing return to education, the growth of inequality between workers of different education levels. So we come away from that saying that the real cost of trade from the welfare perspective is really the adjustment, that the long-run effects, they're not zero, and we should care about them, but that's not the big, that's not the magnitude of the change that people are feeling. What they're really feeling is the concentrated impact on workers who lose employment, on local labor markets that house manufacturing, on industries and communities that go into decline, not the general change in the wage level for the entire U.S. economy. Okay, so now let me turn, has the policy response been effective? Well, in paper, trade adjustment assistance is our main policy tool. But the actual policy response that we see in the data has very little to do with trade adjustment. It has much more to do with other social transfer programs. So in particular, we find that for every $1,000 in trade exposure of a local labor market, that was the metric that Gordon was using earlier, this 75-25 metric, you get about $58 per capita in public transfer benefits. Where are those transfer benefits coming from? Well, here we put them in order. About of that $58, $3.65 is unemployment and trade adjustment assistance. Another $8.40 is disability insurance benefits, people exiting the labor force and entering the Social Security disability rolls, which is basically a permanent exit to early retirement from the U.S. labor market. Another $10 in retirement benefits, people taking early retirement. Another $15 in other government income assistance, like SNAP and TANF. And another $18 in Medicare and Medicaid. So although unemployment trade adjustment assistance, they respond elastically in proportional terms, those are big, those are actually, that's bubgas in, to use a Yiddish term, in actual dollars. And most of the dollars is coming from programs that are not directed at returning people to work, right? Not only are they, this is not what those programs were intended for, but even more importantly, they don't have any good incentive effects about getting people back into the labor force. So in thinking, well, how could we deal with this better? What would be the right lessons to draw? Is this the right time for higher trade barriers? Well, there's nothing in our work that says that trade is a net negative for the U.S. economy. All the theory and some evidence suggests it grows the size of the pie, but some slices are getting, in absolute terms, a lot smaller, even as the pie gets a little bit bigger. So what we ought to be thinking about is how to better allocate or divide that pie as it expands. So what might policies look like? Well, one policy idea that people talk about a lot is so-called wage adjustment insurance, or wage insurance. The idea is, you know, when people are displaced from a $20 an hour job, they're reluctant to take a $10 an hour job. They feel like, well, then I've now accepted my reduced stature in life, and I won't be able to find something equally good. And so people tend to hang around, hoping for something better. Well, we know the longer people spend out of the labor market, the less likely they are to get reemployed, and they tend to get reemployed at lower earnings. So the idea of wage insurance is you could say, look, we see you lost your job, $20 an hour, you're gonna take a job at $10 an hour, let's make up $7.50 of that for the first year, and $5 an hour for the second year, and $2.50 for the third year, and then zero after that. And so you help people make that adjustment. Psychically, you get them back, you compensate them for some of the loss, you help them get them back into the labor force quickly, and perhaps that leads to a better trajectory relative to waiting around. That's one possibility. Another possibility, which I think would be more politically palatable and kind of much more shovel-ready, would be expanding the earned income tax credit to a general workers' credit. So right now, the earned income tax credit is a very effective and generous social program for people with dependent children. So if you're a family with three or four dependent children, you can get up to $6,000 a year in wage subsidy at the margin. You're paid more for working. If you're, let's say you're a middle-aged man and you have children, but they've gone off to college, so you don't have any dependents any longer, you can get $400 a year in the earned income tax credit. So the EITC is a policy that can make work more attractive, pay better for everyone if it were expanded in that direction, if we changed the rules such that it was a broader set of subsidies. And the other useful thing about that is it doesn't have to be trade specific. You know, people are displaced by machines all the time. Is that, do we care less about them than, you know, if they're displaced by a foreign worker as opposed to a domestic robot? I would say we don't. Moreover, sometimes when workers, you know, imagine a community that loses 1,000 manufacturing jobs, well, people are going to stop going to restaurants and they're going to stop buying cars. Well, that's going to reduce employment in those sectors. Should those workers receive trade adjustment assistance? Very hard to figure that out. So better to have a broader policy that supports work and supports reemployment. And most other countries do more of this than we do. Our workforce design safety net is decades out of date, has changed very little in the last 70 years. Many other countries are aware of the cost of job loss and both support workers, but also very strongly and actively encourage them, give them incentives, carrots and sticks, to get them back into the workforce. Let me make a final point on this. When you think we're going to have to make this trade adjustment, should we sort of just rip the Band-Aid off and get it over with, or should we go slowly? Well, I think many people have the instinct that shock therapy is better, just get the pain over with and then one and done. But in labor markets, that's never going to be true because careers are finite. And if an industry is going to sunset over the course of 10 or 20 years, well, there'll be retirements, there'll be attrition, people won't enter that sector because they know it's shutting down. And so there's a natural process through which an industry ebbs and flows. But if you made that same adjustment in the course of a year or a month and everything shut down, well, that's a huge amount of disruption. So even for the same amount of adjustment, making it more gradual reduces the total amount of pain, not just the total amount of pain in the time period, but the total amount of suffering that occurs because the natural adjustment process can take place much more effectively over time than it can overnight. Okay, so just to conclude, important to stress, China trade impacts of the future will look quite different from the past. The worst of the China shock, as we've measured it, is over. China has now hit many of its own internal constraints. Its manufacturing employment is falling. And so even if we did nothing at all, the next 20 years would look nothing like the last 20. We are not about to experience the same thing again. I think that's a lesson that is not reaching our political discourse whatsoever. I think many people think this is just the beginning, and it's not. A second lesson that we would take away is that Donald Trump and Bernie Sanders are not as surprising in retrospect as they appeared 6 months ago. And our recent work on the political polarization effects of trade shows that the polarization of the House of Representatives that's been going on for some decades was very concentrated in the last 10 years in trade-impacted locations, both elections of extreme conservatives and in non-white districts, pretty strong liberals. So there's this kind of political fracturing along geographically trade-impacted lines that naturally reverberate in this election. So we would say the inattention to the negative labor market consequence of trade have actually helped to catalyze opposition, that trade boosterism has actually in some ways been the enemy of trade policy. And a mature conversation that recognizes that these costs, that these costs are real, that we should recognize the benefits from trade and recognize that certain individuals are going to be made worse off, and then develop policy that helps mitigate those adverse impacts, that's much more effective, more palatable in the long run than simply saying, it's good for you, shut up, don't complain, everyone benefits. That's not true. Our work, we hope, has the effect of contributing to a conversation about making trade adjustment more effective, making the benefits shared and the concentrated losses less adverse and less painful in total. Okay, thanks very much.
Well, thank you. This is a real delight to be able to speak to this paper to comment on what I'll call ADH, Shorter Dorn Hansen, the China shock, because I've probably read at least 100 papers about trade and wages, and this one is my favorite. I think it's extremely strong empirical work, really a solid notch above much of what's come before, including some of what David spoke about, and I'll get into that a little bit. But the nice part is that if you really agree with a paper, you don't have to spend a lot of time quibbling about coefficients and specifications and things like that, and you can get into some more fruitful discussion of the type I think David just usefully took us through regarding the political economy of trade in this incredibly unique moment, where something very important and very big, and that's the benefits of trade, not just to us, by the way, but in many ways more importantly to impoverished countries who can only improve their living standards through trading with wealthier countries like ours. Those benefits are very much at risk, and I completely agree with where I think David was at the end, that one of the reasons they're at risk is because too many of us in this field have been abject cheerleaders for trade without taking the time to look at some of the costs, as ADH have done in this and a series of other papers. I've been part of a kind of a small band of economists who've been trying to do that for a long time, but we were typically skunks at garden parties and kicked out of polite places in many cases, because if you said anything critical about the costs of trade, you were thought to be a protectionist. I hope my comments so far about the important benefits of trade, not just to us, but to our trading partners, would completely obviate that accusation. Not only am I not a protectionist, but my family is comprised of two children from China, so I wake up in a global household every morning, often much earlier than I'd like to. let me see if I can. However, I have one disagreement that I'll get into, because I think it's more fun if you have at least one disagreement, and that's vis-a-vis bullet point two. That seemed like a bigger part of their discussion, of Gordon and particularly David's discussion today, was this argument with Larry Michel, who is a good and longtime friend of mine, I should get that on the table, about whether the impacts of trade are acute versus diverse. Is this meme regarding trade impacts true? I just heard Mike Froman speak the other day. We were at a conference together, and he made many good points. One of the points he made that I disagree with, and I think Gordon and David agree with, so this is a point of disagreement between us, is it's a typical meme, or I'm not even sure what that word means, but it's a kind of a internet theme, I guess, or something, but it's something everybody believes to be true, but maybe isn't. It's this idea that the benefits of trade are diffuse because we benefit from the increased supply of goods, downward pressure on prices. The benefits are diffuse, but the costs are acute. And that's why it's such a fractious political issue and why Trump et al. Can have such traction here, because people don't really recognize the benefits because they're so diffuse. But the people who are acutely hurt, as in ADH, do. So I actually think that ADH's results really give much more support to the costs of trade being quite diffuse, not acute, not simply acute. Now, the worst of those costs are highly acute, but their work, I think, shows quite clearly that the costs of trade to non-college educated workers are quite are real, but they're a lot smaller than the direct effects. One of the problems you get into here is you start throwing adjectives around, and that's always bad for economists to do. Smaller, I don't know how to, yes, definitely the indirect effects are smaller than the direct effects, but I don't know how to rank those on a scale of what people really care about on some sort of utility or political margin. I'll say a little bit more about that as I go along. And by the way, you heard Gordon say that non-college educated workers have been hurt. Well, what I think you really should say when you say that is that most workers are non-college educated workers. That actually the share of workers with a four-year college degree or above is maybe a third now. So the costs are much smaller in their work, absolutely much smaller in their work, and you might want to call them trivially small if you want to throw that adjective around. But they're definitely there, and they're definitely diffuse. So I'll say more. That's the one thing we disagree with. Let me just keep going here. I do want to, and I see my friend Jay Shambaugh is here, who knows a lot about that fourth bullet. And Jay, I hope you jump in here at some point, because Jay's with the Council of Economic Advisors. I think there are a set of problems in global macro right now that ADH don't really deal with in their paper. Not a criticism; it's not part of their work. But they both know a lot about this. I'm sure Gordon has thought about these. And there are problems in global macro right now that loom large here at the Peterson Institute that I think threaten to amplify some of the effects that ADH find. And then I'm completely with David. In fact, he did such a good job on this last bullet point that I can save some time. I was going to talk about the EITC too, but he beat me to that. I'm going to spend very little time on this. I was going to talk about David didn't get into this because he was being modest. There's nothing obviously wrong with the factor. The work on factor content and trade flows, in my view, is far inferior to what ADH have done. Now, that's what I mean when I say they've really advanced the debate. I'm not criticizing any of the people who use the factor content approach because it's a lot, frankly, it's a lot easier to do. You don't have to crunch the microdata the way these guys have done. But the problem with the earlier work on factor content, which, as David says, it just takes the shifts in supply in natural skill proportion, and it maps those onto wage effects using elasticities. Well, when you trade with LDCs, less developed countries, and you're using factor content, you cannot find anything other than the fact that it's going to lower wages. And I don't particularly, that happens to be something I believe to be true, but I'm very wary of confirmation biases, and I don't really like statistical exercises that predict the answer before you even get there. In their work, I mean, they can correct me if I'm wrong, but in their work, if import penetration from China didn't have the kind of effects they found, their coefficients would have been insignificant. And so I think the factor content work, both because it's highly aggregated and because it has the answer built into it, is inferior to the work they've done here. Other analysts will take the trade deficit, map that onto job losses through an input-output matrix, and again, talk about the costs. And I happen to myself have subscribed to some of that research, but I would say that's also a level or two down analytically from what ADH have done. So it's a great improvement. I did want to talk a little bit, maybe I'll get into this, and I know Jay's thought about this as well. So China shock, yes, as David pointed out, the China shock at some level has... it may be seen as over. I'm not so sure. But certainly, I think China currency is reasonably aligned. I don't think China's manipulating their currency now. But there are other countries who have very large trade surpluses. Germany, most notably, a trade surplus of 8% of GDP. That I'm going to argue that creates serious imbalances and shocks to other countries, other parts of the globe. And so one of my questions for ADH is, to what extent can you extend this work to other places, other countries, even if the China shock is behind us? And I'm going to argue I'm not so sure. That doesn't mean other shocks aren't out there. They would not disagree with that. I seem to have missed. This is the part where we argue a little bit. And I don't want to overdo it, because I'm going to make this sound like a bigger argument than it is. I think they've got it right, which is that the direct costs are you could say large if you wanted to use an adjective. The direct costs are the size they showed, and they look quite significant to the incomes of affected workers. The indirect costs are considerably lower, and I don't know what they are exactly, but I do know that they're diffuse, and I think their research shows that. Josh Bibbins has a model wherein he finds the impact on non-college-educated workers, which are the majority of the workforce. By the way, that includes people with some college, but about two-thirds of the workforce does not have a terminal college degree of some sort. And that's very much an upper bound. That's very much higher than what ADH would find. And Josh's work comes from a CGE model that is much more in the spirit of the factor content than the microanalysis that ADH does. And it very much works off this notion of factor price equalization, which is when your trade with low-wage countries go up, and I think David et al., maybe it was Gordon, talked about this in the context of Stolper-Samuelson, the impact on your scarce factor, which is we have a lower share of low-wage workers than they do, is going to be negative on the wage side, and that's where the adjustment takes place in the Bibbins model. But that may be an upper bound. It certainly, again, is more of the assumed impact than the measured one. Josh is a very smart trade economist. And in fact, ADH confirmed that factor price equalization is very much operative. They just argue that it's not particularly diffuse. But I'd actually like to hear them talk more about, like, what by what model do these impacts not diffuse, or even by what standard do you say they're not diffuse? So if you look at their map, which I won't throw up here, but if you look at their map on panel B, which looks at the quartiles of exposed workers, that is, commuting zones or parts of the country that are exposed to the China shock, and you look at the top half, the top two quartiles, a lot of that map is either dark or less dark. I can't do colors, so I hate these maps. They make no sense to me. The era of Raj Chetty has killed me from being able to understand a lot of this research. But I can see that a bunch of this map, a lot more than not, is affected. Now, again, affected in a way that they may want to call small, but affected in terms of wage losses. They tell you that 70% of manufacturing job losses have been are accounted for by the China shock. Now, not every community has manufacturing in it, but those that do are certainly highly visible. 17. What did I say? 17. I wrote 17. 17 is, 70 would be a disaster. 17 to me is, 5 minutes, great. 17 to me is a very, very significant share of the problem. But again, calibrating this stuff is maybe a matter of adjectives. On the other hand, I think that the diffuse costs and the fact that they're smaller, the ADH are definitely right that they're smaller than the direct costs, get overweighted in the political debate in ways that are familiar to all of us and that David and others have talked about. And here Mike Froman said something that I thought was quite profound. He said, somebody said to him in this conference, why is there so much anger about trade? When we can look at these and we can say, well, if order et al are right, 17% of manufacturing employment lost due to the China shock. I think that's important and it sounds pretty diffuse to me. But it's not 83%. And what Froman said is that nobody gets to vote on technology, which is a kind of obscure way to say that the thing that people get to vote on, argue about, take a stand on, is trade. That's the thing that's the phenomenon, the structural change within the economy that carries a hugely disproportionate part of the weight for everything that ails us. I mean, David talked about the 2000s as a lost decade, and I've heard other people say that. And if you look at the median household income, it's a fair statement. And trade is not the only reason for that by a long shot, and David and Gordon would agree with that. But it carries that freight because people get to vote on it, to have an opinion on it, to take a position on the TPC. And that brings us to this unique moment. Yesterday I read in the New York Times, just last night, while I was trying to have dinner and reading about Trump, which is a terrible idea, digestion-wise, Donald Trump said trade is killing the country. And then he said the markets would be fine with a 35% tariffs on multinationals that outsource. That is bat crazy, and maybe our next president. So we are in a unique and critical moment when statements like that can be heard. Where does that come from? Why does that resonate with so many people? Which it does, by the way. And if you don't think it does, you need to get out more. One reason has to do with this little slide. The squiggly line is the trade deficit as a share of GDP. That's on the right axis. And the other line is the manufacturing compensation in real dollars from the 1950s to now. And I'm not saying that these two caused each other directly by a long shot, or two lines on a graph. And by the way, you can see the China shock there as the trade deficit share of GDP goes to -6% in the 2000s. But people reasonably would associate the fact that when the trade deficit share of GDP was zero, manufacturing compensation, these are blue-collar workers, by the way, doubled from about 12 to about 25 bucks. And as the trade deficit has been persistently negative, and by the way, that's large in economic terms, that's a lot of growth to offset, that wage hasn't grown at all. So that's one reason why this message gets to be so resonant. People make that connection. Another reason is because Hillary Clinton opposes the TPP. Now, that's another discussion that we can have, but certainly when an establishment politician who's a front runner on the Democratic side says, I don't think that helps workers enough, that's going to elevate this as well. China currency, which happens to be aligned. The thing I wanted to say, especially since I'm here at the Peterson Institute, where Joe Gagnon does a lot of great work, as along with Fred and others, is, okay, so I definitely agree that the China shock is over from a perspective of the kind of import penetration lines that they showed, but China still holds large reserves. And you know, Gagnon's work himself shows, I've talked to Joe about this, that just simply holding trillions in reserves does put upward pressure on the dollar. I think it's probably de minimis relative to some of the more direct interventions, but I wouldn't write it off. And while Donald Trump is wrong when he talks about China currency manipulation, as I'll show in a second from a slide of Jay's, that sort of thing still goes on. And then most notably, by the way, the most important thing, and here's why this is such an indelible contribution, is our ADH effects, what you just heard. And ADH are very clear in making the political connection between this unique moment and so and so. Okay, I'm gonna stop in a second. Elites have been cavalier about the costs of trade. I said that. Let me just do this and then I'll stop. So give me another minute if you would, because my policy points were largely made by David. And maybe we'll have more chance to talk about them in Q&A. So beyond ADH, I think we have a problem in global macroeconomics that is exacerbating trade deficits and triggering the kinds of, if not shock effects, but triggering some of the pressures that ADH find in measuring the China shock. Ben Bernanke talks about a savings glut, where countries, many whom are acting in a mercantilist fashion, have suppressed investment and increased their savings, exporting savings here, importing labor demand there. This is something that Ben Bernanke was writing about in 2005. He thought it would be kind of a temporary problem. I think that the secular stagnationists have recognized that it's a tougher one than that. In a very important new paper by Egertson et al., Larry Summers is an author on that, they show that K-star right there, those are capital flows, and this is just a kind of a typical macroeconomic formula for the growth of output. But notice that in open macro now, these guys are including capital flows as a negative factor. And in fact, one of the things we've seen in recent months is that as capital flows have come here seeking safe assets, you've had this savings investment imbalance that Larry Summers tells you underlies secular stagnation, such that the desire for savings is greater than the desire for investment, puts downward pressure on interest rates, puts upward pressure on the dollar. And so I would include this, and again, I hope Jay will comment on this, I would include this as a relatively new or at least newly recognized pressure in a zero-bound economy that's creating global macro problems that exacerbate ADH effects. This, I should just show this because it's Jay's slide. This is just a slide from Jay showing the extent of current account imbalances. There's that 8% Germany surplus and the IMF sustainability target showing that some currencies are undervalued, some currencies are overvalued. So even while China is just about appropriately valued, it doesn't mean that everybody else is. So just closing here. What I'd like, and here I'd like to make a proposal to my friends at the Peterson Institute, to Fred, to Adam Posen, if you're listening, Adam, which is that I think we have a real difficulty with free trade agreements. I, like many others, and I think this is as comes out of Gordon and Hanson, I think that there is a big difference between trade and globalization, which can be and should be a force for good, and free trade agreements, which have become a process by which stakeholders, often from a sector that doesn't represent working people, are having too much influence. And so I would argue that the FTA process is kind of broken. And even if you don't believe that, I predict that we're not going to see much in the way of FTAs for a while. Now, it happens to be that there are 300 FTAs already in the world, and perhaps we can work on negotiating rules within them. And I have some other ideas that I think would help. In the interest of time, I won't go through them right now. TFAs are trade facilitation agreements. I actually think there might be more of a margin to do stuff there. But at the end of the day, I think it's a unique moment. And I think we can usefully tap it together if we stop having these fractious fights about free trade agreements, which I think is kind of a cul-de-sac to nowhere right now, and start thinking about ways to do what I think David particularly said at the end of his talk, promote the benefits of trade, which is going to mean really taking seriously, in a way that we haven't before, winners compensating losers. Theoretically, free trade has always been a big seller because the winners can compensate the losers, but they don't. And in fact, the power that the winners have accumulated in our era of wealth inequality has made that a consistent problem for folks, and now we're seeing it in our political economy. Thanks very much.
Okay, many thanks to all three speakers for putting an enormous amount on the table. I want to start with one question and then we open the floor. To David, particularly, and Gordon, your bottom line was that the U.S. labor force is not sufficiently flexible and adaptable to adjust to this particular source of dynamic economic change. Why has the U.S. labor force become less flexible than we all thought it was, and so thereby cause this problem?
It's not obvious that it was ever as flexible as we thought it was. And I think that's what we see from the evidence on displaced workers, you know, in steel in the 1980s, that actually involuntary job loss for mid-career workers is extremely costly. We just hadn't seen it associated with trade because the trade adjustments hadn't been of the same magnitude. There's a school of thought. There's certainly, I've been in discussions with people where they said, well, this is all because of this, you know, the social safety hammock that has discouraged workers from seeking, you know, to just go on to the benefits. I'm really not convinced that's true. I really think it's that we're seeing this a very large shock, and we're seeing displaced workers, and that's the typical response that occurs when you have impacts of that magnitude. That may not be 100% of it. We know that geographic mobility across states and counties in the U.S. has been on the decline for several decades. The workforce is older. So there may be some other structural changes. I do not think is primarily due to the creeping ivy of the social safety net.
Okay, floor is open for questions. Yeah, we've got a traveling mic. We've got a standing mic in the back. We'll start here. Ralph, identify yourself and then fire your question, and then we'll go to Bob next.
Hi, thanks. Ralph Carter with FedEx. In the first presentation, the last bullet point talked about gradual adjustments, that if we could have gradual adjustments through attrition and other things, the impact would be reduced. But are you saying that we can control the pace of those adjustments, or is there a policy fix that could look at that? I didn't understand kind of what the conclusion was, or the action point there was.
We can't control it all, but we can at least be aware of that, right? So, you know, a lot of the China trade shock is about internal adjustments in China that allowed it to grow to the place it should be. So a lot of those were not in our control, although, you know, the WTO agreement was to some extent. But in negotiating future trade treaties, we could think about if we're going to cut tariffs, we should sunset them rather than do it overnight, for example. So the point was, is not that we have complete control over the way economies integrate, but we can, when we decide to open ourselves up, we can think about the trajectory of that as opposed to simply the end point.
I think another important point there is that once you have openness to trade and capital flows, you are then exposed to big shocks that happen in the rest of the world. China was a big shock. And so that puts an extra premium on policy planning to account for disruptions that might come down the line. And we were simply remiss in that sort of planning over the last couple of decades.
I would just amplify one thing David said. When we negotiate trade agreements, we do frequently use long phase-in periods for the liberalization in order to ease the transition over time. And in sensitive sectors where there's a lot of domestic concern, that is frequently done. Time is sort of the great leavening force. And that's been a traditional technique in trade agreements. Some of the transitional phase-ins in TPP exceed 20 years. So that is a technique, and that's one way to go about the question. Bob.
Bob Samuelson, The Washington Post. This is questions for David and Gordon. Exports must have some effect both on consumer welfare, but more importantly, from your point of view, on the local labor markets. And I'm unclear from your discussion as to whether or not you take that into account and what you're talking about are net effects of the China shock, or whether you simply, for whatever reasons, did not take it into account.
Great question. And we did very much focus on U.S. exports to China as well. The results I showed you were for gross imports of the U.S. from China. In all of our work, we also look at net imports, U.S. imports minus those exports to China. It so happens over the time period, in part for some of the reasons that Jared mentioned, is that trade imbalances made it such that U.S. imports from China completely dwarfed U.S. exports to China. And so, to a first approximation, the China trade shock was an import shock. Now, in the long run, we expect adjustment to occur that will allow U.S. exports to expand, and that will create new job opportunities in those industries that export to China. We would have thought, I think if you were asking us this question in 1991, that 2016 would have been the long run. But you look at U.S. trade accounts today, and we aren't there yet.
So if I could just say a word about that, if that's okay.
Sure, Jared.
Just
sure.
Quickly.
Sure,
sure. The trade deficit as a share of GDP is about 3% right now. That's about the average over the last 15 or 20 years, and that's a considerable drag on GDP. Neil Irwin wrote a smart piece the other day in the New York Times, where he said, the trade deficit is not a scorecard. It doesn't mean, big trade deficit bad, trade surplus good. And in fact, we've had periods of full employment with large trade deficits. But we've gotten there through bubbles. And these dynamics that I tried to describe in that little slide on global macro suggest that, to me, that those phenomena are related. That in a world with capital flows being what they are, with the dollar as the reserve currency and with some currency manipulation, that trade balances are going to be offset by bubbles unless we take a better action.
I just want to add one final point on this. Important to stress, it's not exports good, imports bad. But if we run a large trade deficit, it does mean that the reallocation that has to occur is larger because you won't have manufacturing. It will be very non-neutral for manufacturing employment because when we export, we're going to be exporting manufactured goods. So if we just have a large trade deficit, it means a lot of workers who leave manufacturing need to go find employment elsewhere in some other sector altogether, and that's harder. So I would say the scale of the worker adjustment that has to be made in the face of a large trade deficit is different from the scale when we had a lot of imports and exports simultaneously because there'd be more manufacturing activity to absorb them.
Next at the mic.
Hi, Nilar Sagan from Voice of America. We don't have a lot of specifics, but by now we've probably heard a little bit about what Donald Trump wants to do in terms of foreign policy. I'm just wondering if any of your studies have actually factored in the cost or perhaps the impact of what a Donald Trump presidency would have on global trade?
So all the work we've done is retrospective. We can understand what trade impacts have been on the U.S. economy. I think journalists have shown that they are as good at forecasting as economists are. We had some nice...
But we count on you as our experts.
Yeah. But what you can say is, we now live in a global world, and if enacting 45% tariffs on China is not going to take us back to 1955. If we forced U.S. shoe production to come back to the U.S., it wouldn't be the same labor-intensive shoe production that we saw in New Hampshire in the 1960s. It would be something fundamentally different. So you can see why he does it politically, but the economic foundation for it, shockingly enough, isn't there.
I would refer you to a piece that I posted on the Institute's website about 2 weeks ago, I didn't give a quantitative estimate to answer your question, but I did note that U.S. domestic law would preclude Trump from doing a lot of the things that he says he would do. So even if you took him at his word that he really wanted to do those things, there would be some severe limits on how much he could carry them out. They would still be very damaging. They would still be extremely costly. I would strongly oppose them. But to put in perspective the possible outcomes, U.S. domestic law and the international system, which we've adopted in our legal system here at home, do fortunately put a lot of constraints on what can be done. I mean, ironically, the U.S. led the creation of a global trading system in order to put constraints on what other countries could do against us. It might turn out that luckily we put some constraints on what we could do ourselves. And that might apply in the case that you pose.
But just follow up, even if he does, is unable to follow up on some of the his proposals, including a 45% tariff tax, I'm hearing a lot of economists telling me that that would lead to a possible trade war if he were to propose such things.
Well, there's no doubt. U.S. law permits a president to raise tariffs by 15% for 5 months. Period, unless he declares a national security emergency. Now, he might do that, but short of that, 15% for 5 months. But whatever he did, I think there's no doubt, at least in the case of China, they would retaliate. They would take the U.S. to the WTO as a violation of our obligations there, but they wouldn't wait the 3 years for the cases to run. They would retaliate in the meanwhile, being fairly confident they would prevail in the case at the end of the day. So if one calls a trade war a retaliation of that type, as journalists frequently do, then yes, you would have it. What my analysis suggested was two simple things. If you limit imports from a single country like China, those imports are going to be available in most cases from other countries. So the reduction in U.S. net imports would be very modest. By contrast, the countries that we hit would retaliate against us. They could buy most of those products elsewhere. We would lose much more on the export side than we gained on the import side in mercantilist trade balance and job terms. So my headline in my piece was Trump's trade policy, a big loser for the United States. Not that we're going to win again, but it would be a big loser for those fairly straightforward reasons. You've had your question.
Okay.
Go on to the next one. Next one, nod.
Hi, Steve Sylvia from American University. I have a question. Workers, of course, are going to be in an economy that doesn't only have China, but has a whole range of competitors who are sending imports. When you take China alone the way you've done it, you're going to exaggerate a rise given the time period that you've taken in terms of trade exposure. Have you ever done a robustness check with your data looking at all trade and seeing how that played out?
So what we have done is not look at all trade, but all but trade with all low-wage countries, and say, you know, what maybe what we're picking up is there are full substitution effects here. So any expansion of China means a loss in imports from Mexico or Central America or Vietnam and so forth. And what we find is almost identical answers when we look at trade with all-wage low-wage countries as trade with China, and that's just because the magnitude of China's growth of this time period is so enormous.
Next.
Hi, Doug Palmer with Politico. I just wanted to follow up on one of the points in the presentation. When you said that you thought that the worst effects of the China shock were over, I mean, is that the same as saying that the worst effects of globalization are over? I mean, is there another shock that's out there that could be comparable to the China shock? I mean, Mr. Bernstein referred to Germany's trade surplus. I mean, is that of the same magnitude as China?
So when we say the worst of the China shock, you want to qualify this and remember that globalization does lots of really good things for the U.S. economy. So I wouldn't, instead of saying the worst of it, you might think of it, the most disruptive aspects of China's development we have, in fact, lived through. And that's because you've already moved 250 million workers from the countryside to cities. China has developed its manufacturing sector, and as a share of its economy, it's now pretty stable. That transition is something
we're not going to witness again. And there's no other part of the world where we're likely to see as momentous of a shift from agriculture, backward parts of the economy, to manufacturing in as short of a time period.
Yeah, just in terms of magnitude, the only possible parallel would be an India shock. But to put it mildly, India's international competitiveness is not nearly what China's had. Their policy orientation is not in that openness direction, at least in this point, although theoretically with that kind of population and still 60% of their economy in agriculture, at least in theory, it would be a possibility.
And let me just say something about the German shock, because I want to be clearly understood. As the analysis here was the impact of the China shock, of course, on U.S. Labor markets. My thinking, and there's been some analysis of this point, is that the German shock is not one that's felt here. It's one that's felt in countries with whom Germany trades considerably, which is going to be typically peripheral. Europe, it's one of the reasons why some countries in the Eurozone have had such difficulty recovering. Essentially, Germany is exporting excess savings to other countries in the zone, in the Eurozone, importing labor demand from them. And even that, so that has been a real shock, but I think even that shock has mitigated a bit lately.
Last question.
Yes, hi, I'm Kim Frankina from GAO. Thank you very much for your research. It's certainly incredibly thought-provoking. I wanted to ask a question about kind of practical application in the TPP context. And in specific, is there anything that could be done now that would avoid, you know, maybe it won't be the size of a shock, but the kind of shock or a shock from TPP? For example, I mean, it looked to me like the uptake in government programs are income support programs, not the kind of, you know, remedy you're talking about, which is something where you actually get a job. So is there something where, you know, those programs can be made more flexible to deal with these kind of situations? Is there a picture of the current economy that could be painted that would help identify which parts of the country are most vulnerable or where we might see more demand for resources? I mean, I'm just looking for some things here. Also, it seems like there's really no champion in Congress for the kind of help for workers that you're talking about. So is there something practical that workers themselves can do to remedy or to prepare for this kind of thing?
So it's important to stress, of course, TPP is mostly about trade promotion. It's not about reducing tariffs that countries face to import to the United States. So it's not going to be nearly as consequential for employment. However, there will be some concentrated impacts, and it would be possible to forecast those looking at specific sectors. I think in terms of what to do about it, I do not think this is something that individual workers can take on. You can't insure yourself against unemployment in the short run. I do think there is opportunity to do this better. And hopefully this public debate and very, you know, politically charged but nevertheless somewhat productive debate can lead to policy, can create an opening where more people would be willing to acknowledge. I mean, a lot of the discussion about trade has been on the one side people saying it's great for everybody, and other people saying, you know, it's really harmful, and not, and it was so fractious that there was no consensus that there was anything that needed to be done about it. You know, either you're for it or against it. I think more people now would be willing to recognize that you could be for it while understanding that it has adverse consequences for some, and that would hopefully catalyze policy as a compromise. I fully expect that if Hillary Clinton becomes president, she will want to put in place policies like something like the expansion of the EITC or earner's credit that are a broad-based labor market employment and wage promotion effort. I think we could learn from the efforts of other countries as well. So I don't think the shock will be as bad. I think we should be better psychically prepared to anticipate it, and that there are things within the realm of political feasibility that could be done about it.
So I just want to clarify one thing about this, and I think it's important. A couple of times David, and I know he knows this difference, I just want to make it very clear to everyone else, has talked about the EITC as a wage subsidy and mentioned employment and reemployment. The EITC is not a jobs program. The EITC doesn't help you if you don't have a job. So one of the things that I'm concerned about. I do think expanding the EITC, particularly up higher up into the income scale, would be a very helpful remedy for the problems we're talking about. But I also think we may need to think about direct job creation, particularly in some of the communities that have been so hard hit.
We could go on for a long time, and we even have questioners waiting, but we've reached our witching hour, and we're going to have to quit. I want to thank David and Gordon and their absent colleague, David Dorn, not only for being with us today, but for really doing the kind of in-depth work on these issues that needed badly to be done, for having enriched really the country and the world's understanding of these issues, and therefore helping pave the way for policy changes that will help preserve the benefits of globalization. We're all deeply in your debt. We thank you for being with us today. Jared, thanks to you for your comments and policy advice. Thanks to the audience for being here. Meeting adjourned.
Thanks very much.